Episode 2183, My Strength is My Story with Peter Demas, Afraid to Trust.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Kristin Wargo. Staring at a
stop sign, watching. Happy, happy day and happy new year. It is on full countdown. How many hours left in your day? Oh, yes, the new year is around the corner, and what better way to celebrate than with the series, My Strength is My Story. We have a special guest today, Peter Demas. And I'm telling you right now, his story is absolutely incredible. He is going to awaken your eye both in your home and in your business. Be ready to have your heart touched today. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Peter's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple strategy, everyday solutions to live, love, and impact. Well, it is almost the new year, and maybe you're actually listening to this after the new year. Happy New Year to you. And I want you to know that Peter has a heart for you as an individual. What he has learned in his journey, his personal journey to God and what that looks like is going to touch your heart. It's going to change your life. There's no better way to start the new year than being fearless. So without further ado, let's welcome in Peter Demas, Afraid to Trust. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have a restaurateur in the house with us, Peter Demas. He is a husband of 21 years to his wife, Kristin, and father to their two children. He is the president and CEO of Demas's Brands and Demas Family Kitchen, and a successful restaurateur, having founded six different Demas restaurant locations and 14 entities, including two PDK Southern Kitchen and Pantry restaurants across Middle Tennessee. If that's not a mouthful. Peter returned to the hospitality industry after earning his law degree. He is a highly requested speaker on the topics of leading with courage and purpose. When he's not serving up something delicious, you will find him writing, as he's a new author of Afraid to Trust, One Man's Journey into the Love of God. Welcome, my friend and brother in Christ. How are you?
Great. Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Thank you so much. You know, it's a crazy time, I got to tell you, but it is a holiday season. We are in 2020. How are your holidays looking so far?
You know, the 2020 has changed everybody's life in all different ways. I mean, you know, I actually had a shirt made to sell at one of our restaurants that 2020 is my excuse for everything, because it seems like every time you turn around, it's just something else is 2020. You know, I actually just gave a speech not that long ago comparing all the events of 2020 to the wilderness and the exodus from the Israelites. I mean, you had plagues, you had quarantines, you had contested elections, you had riots and political unrest. I mean, so it's just like all kind of lines up with it. As far as the holiday season goes, to me, it's just every day, you know, we're just looking to see what we can do and how we can, you know, and how we can survive, you know, in holidays the way it's supposed to be as much as we possibly can. So,
yes, it's kind of a weird new normal. Not that we want to claim it as a new normal, but right now, this too shall pass.
Everything always does. It's just everything has a beginning and end.
Amen.
You know, so since you know everything has a beginning and end, this is nothing different. There's a beginning and end to this. What the next beginning is going to be, we don't know until God reveals it to us. So that makes it a little bit, we're always in that stage. So we shouldn't be surprised that we're in the current stage we're in right now, you know, because, you know, just sometimes it's a little bit different and sometimes a little bit more chaotic than others. But every time there's a stage and we have a response and reaction, and then we get to move to the next step.
Oh, I love that. And the next step is, what brings you joy?
You know, joy is one of those things that's just, there's joy and peace, which is, you know, part of it. And that's the thing. You know, when you look at 2020, you look at COVID, you look at all that stuff, it can't take away your joy and your peace. You know, so all my joy and all my peace comes from Christ. That's who, because it's who I am. Because COVID doesn't take away the fact that I'm a child of God. You know, and a lot of times I think as Christians, we get caught up into whether or not I'm doing the right thing to get into heaven. And we ignore the fact that what our job is to be more Christ-like. And so once we recognize who we are and know what our purpose is, we don't get to change that and define that. You know, the way we do it, we can have a little control over, but our purpose is to glorify God, who we are as a child of God. And so again, so nothing external can actually impact that. And then when we start kind of losing that joy, losing that peace, and we start kind of listening to the world, there are ways that which we need to respond to and react to it, you know, that is such a way that we can find that peace. And what we find when you read his word and you read that, then see that truth that's in there, what we find is you know, we praise and we give thanks and we do that type of stuff. And when you humble yourself, we do that. And Peter, where it says, you know, cast all your anxieties upon Jesus, for he cares about you. Everyone loves to quote that verse, but they ignore the verse right before it. And the verse right before it says, you need to humble yourself before God. And so that's a prerequisite to casting your anxieties. I mean, how does one physically cast an anxiety? You really can't. So what we have to do is we have to do it through humility. And that's how we get back our joy and our peace whenever things start to kind of happen. Those little 3 a.m. moments where you wake up, and you're like, what am I going to do? You know, that's what you do at that point in time.
And I'm sure, unfortunately, a lot of people have been having those 3 a.m. moments. And it is a reminder, though, what you said, we just need to stop for a moment, know that this too shall pass, and that God really does have it. No matter where we are, God has it. Well, God created you. He started very, very young. He knew you in the womb. What was it like for little Peter growing up?
You know, for me, you know, I grew up in a very loving home. I didn't have, you know, my father was in the restaurant business and as well, you know, so, you know, I was around him and that capacity. We would go to church. My father grew up Greek Orthodox. My mother grew up in a rural area as a sharecropper's daughter. And so grew up in a real rural Southern Baptist church. Neither one of them wanted to be part of the upbringing that they were brought up in. So they kind of settled onto being an Episcopalian. And then we moved churches from time to time. That was just kind of one of those, like we did Presbyterian, went back to another Episcopalian church, you know, and did different things based off of whatever reason it happened to be at that moment. I grew up going to a Christian school. But ultimately, during all those times, even though they did, in my opinion, everything they knew to do for what they knew to do, I grew up really not liking Christians. I grew up very antagonistic. I ended up being very antagonistic to them because, you know, being around, you know, going to Sunday schools and I was a questioner. I remember one time stopping the line to question the priest about something, and I was about 5-6 years old. And I didn't like his answer, and I tried to argue with him at 5 and 6 years old. And, you know, so those are the type of stuff that I did, and I engaged him that ultimately ended up becoming, I ended up becoming very, very antagonistic and would seek out Christians in order to embarrass them in a different way. So growing up, that was kind of how I grew up. And it just, like I said, it ended up doing the exact opposite that many people would have expected.
Well, and it's unfortunate that you had that experience. However, we know later on, because I read the book, we'll tell the story a little bit later, a piece of it, not all of it, because people are going to want to pick up their own copy of Afraid to Trust. But you went to law school, you got married, had children, you did life, right? And decided to actually come back home. What drew you back home to the family business?
Well, you know, it was, you have the chronology slightly off there. What ended up happening was I went to law school, decided to come back work as a lawyer. And I remember sitting, and when I came back, I met my wife. I would work part-time in the restaurant while I was practicing law. And I met her in that capacity. Most people weren't speaking to me. They were nervous about me being in there. And I walked into her server section, and she told me to get out. And I thought she was joking because no one would dare do that. And so I was like, okay, she must be joking. And so I started kind of joking back with her and playing around with her. 3.5 months later, we were engaged. And less than a year after we met, we were married. But 2 weeks into the engagement, I was sitting at I really wasn't enjoying law. I did law in order to try to help people. I read all these civil rights books and these, you know, growing up and you know, reading all this stuff about these lawyers. And but most of the law is not like those books. You know, they might have one case, but it wasn't their everyday practice. And so I was sitting in the law office and I was listening to two lawyers have a conversation. And I thought, I just don't want to have that conversation in 10, 15 years. Nothing wrong with it. It wasn't bad. It wasn't evil. Just didn't want to be that. And so I thought, well, I'll practice law part-time and work in the restaurant full-time. And so I got back in. So 2 weeks after we got engaged, I came home and told Kristin, I said, hey, I'm going back in the restaurant business and with the family and, you know, didn't realize at that time, those are things you're supposed to talk to your future wife about. But, you know, it is what it is now. And I've been in it now since that long. So, but I've been back in it since about 22 years now.
Wow. What a story. Well, there is a lot of intertwining in there. So no wonder I got a few things a little bit backwards. Oh, yeah. For sure.
Well, it happened so fast. It all seemed to be at one time anyway. So it works out.
That's right. Well, and it does. Sometimes you find yourself in the middle of one and at a place for another. Life continued to unfold for you. It went on, it went on. However, there was a life roundabout that happened that you did not see coming. Where did God meet you?
Well, God, you know, God, you know, again, you know, I grew up, like I said, pretty antagonistic. You know, I just to give you an idea, I read the transcripts of the Scopes Monkey trial so I can see what Clarence Darrow did to William Jennings Bryant. And so I would ask Christians those questions, but I never really was an atheist. I always believed he was there, but I said he needed to be an absentee landlord. You know, he was up there, I'm down here, we don't meet, we don't talk, and that's okay. You know, if your pipe's burst, you call and ask for help, and that's about it. And so we had that, and that was kind of how I thought it should be. And as long as I just do enough good things, then I'll get into heaven and claim I'm a Christian, show up at church every now and then, and that was it. Well, my wife, she had, I think it was 7 Southern Baptist preachers in her family. So, you know, she grew up very entrenched in it. And so we just kind of, we didn't always agree on it. And then when we had kids, I was like, okay, we'll take them to church. And they hated it. And I'm like, well, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to hate church. So it's okay. You know, I didn't think anything about it. And we kept going to, and she was surprised. So she kept trying to find different churches. And she finally found one that the kids liked. And I would go every now and then. The pastor was a smart, very, very smart, intelligent man. I still go there. It's World Outreach Church. And one of the things that I noticed was, in addition to him, you know, being very intelligent, there was a whole lot that was going on, you know, that I didn't see in many other churches. You know, the people were really friendly. They were kind. You know, they tried to walk out their faith in a lot of different ways. You know, not perfect, but they tried. You know, but again, I didn't go often because I just didn't want to go. Well, she made me go. We got in several fights, and it's outlined in the book. We got in several fights on the way to see a speaker that they had named Angus Buchan. And Angus, there's a movie called Faith Like Potatoes about him. Great movie. He's a South African evangelist. And he came and he did an altar call. And for the first time, I went up. Matter of fact, to tell you how bad of a shape I was in, when he did the altar call and I started to go up, she wasn't going to let me go up. She didn't move because she thought I was leaving. And so I still can see the look on her face. And I'll probably on my deathbed can remember the look of her face of surprise when I was heading up that direction. So, but the next 3 days, the next day I ended up again through a series of very, very, strange events of God working different things. I ended up in front of Angus and, he asked the question. He said, if you're willing to die for your country, why are you afraid to speak out for God? And nobody's ever said I was afraid of anything before. I was always been a fighter. And so I had to leave. I had to go to Memphis. And I was there for 3 days. I slept for 4 hours, just wrestling of what's it like to be a Christian? What am I supposed to do? All of this. And then at the end of that period of time, I was taking a shower. I had to leave and drive back, and I was exhausted. I was worried about driving back. I was thinking, even should I stay another night, you know, get some sleep? And finally, I just screamed out, God, you win. I'm turning everything over to you. And at that point in time, you know, I fell on my knees and I felt everything just kind of lift up and out, all fears, insecurities, things I didn't know I had, just kind of went out and everything at that point in time changed. And that was when it was okay, now what does that mean to turn everything over to you? Like, how does that actually look like? And that was where I had to kind of start from there.
Oh my goodness. Well, praise the Lord. I mean, God has a way, even in the shower, to draw us to our knees. It gives a whole nother picture of Adam and Eve counts. I'm just saying. But, you know, he does. He always comes at us where we are ready and willing. And he softened that heart enough for you, Peter. And he knew that at that moment, he needed to show up. And it was amazing for you. It totally changed. For decades you lived, though, fear-fueled. Fear was leading you. It was a mindset that wreaked havoc on your career, your home life, and marriage. Yet your encounter with God immediately impacted your entire life. How did that show up? What did that look like going back after you arrived home?
Well, you know, the thing about it was that you don't realize that you're living in fear, you know, in a lot of ways. Because like I said, I was a fighter, so I didn't seem like I was afraid of anything. But fear can manifest itself in a lot of different ways. So like at work, it would manifest itself into anger, micromanaging. You know, I would scream and throw stuff. And, you know, I took cussing to an art form. I could put cuss words in the middle of words with no problem at all. You know, at home, I was very jealous. I did not have, you know, my wife and I even had seen a marriage counselor, and a couple of years before this event that took place, we even had the marriage counselor tell us that we needed to get a divorce, that we were in such a bad, bad place. And what she did, she changed everything. She went home, instead of praying for God to change me, she changed it to God, teach me how to love him. And that's when things started to change and started changing in our marriage, and eventually opened that up. So, you know, I immediately came home and started, you know, I was on fire, you know. So my wife actually has a chapter in the book. It's called Jealous of Jesus, because I came home with such fire and such energy, and just all I could do was just read the Bible, read Christian works and nonfiction, and trying to understand. I just had an appetite that I couldn't fix. I mean, it was just constantly listening to sermons from everybody, listening, you know, to podcasts, everything I could possibly do. I was just filling everything in as much as I could. And, but she, you know, and like I said, she was not very happy about it at first. One would think you are, but what ended up happening was Jesus became first in my life, which moved her second. And so she kind of had to learn kind of that piece of it. The other problem was that she was always a spiritual leader in the home. And so there was a little bit of that problem and that competition of that. And that was at home. My kids, on the other hand, remember it completely different. They remember Peter before Christ as one who would yell at him a lot, get angry. You know, now, and it's like, it's not like I don't yell anymore. It's not like I don't get angry anymore. You know, but they see it as different, because they can see it as they describe it as, now when you get angry, you at least explain the reason why afterward. You know, we know that, you know, there's a security with it. Just like me and Kristin, there's a security when we have the problem. On the work side, we said, okay, well, this is going to be our ministry now. We have employees that don't know Christ. And it started with a conversation I would ask them, do you know the story of Moses, or do you know the story of Abraham? And 2 out of 12 knew who Moses was, and 3 out of 12 knew who Moses was, and 2 knew who Abraham was. And these are people that Hollywood made movies about, you know, and they didn't know. And so, you know, it's not like I said, oh, hey, let me tell you about Hezekiah. You know, I mean, it wasn't anything of that nature. And so because of that, so we started kind of realizing that's our area needed to be. And that's where we started trying to make the change within our work and within our using work as a ministry. And it became God was our director, managing director at that point in time.
Wow, that's incredible. And you talk about that in your book, which I would encourage everybody to pick a copy up of their own, Afraid to Trust, One Man's Journey into the Love of God. We can't get to all the stories, obviously, in the book and what you tell and what you share. There's a lot of good life lessons in this. But since we're talking about fear, why do you think it's so prevalent today?
You know, well, partly I think, in my opinion, the reason why fear is so prevalent is because we keep looking to the world. We keep placing security in worldly things. And everything that we put security in worldly things can be stripped away from us. And whenever, again, we don't recognize that who we are in Christ, or we define who we are by who we're married to, or we define who we are by what I do for a living, or who I am based off of how much money I have, or what school I go to, and all that stuff, God can take that away in a moment. And so whenever you base things on your reputation is another one, whenever you base it off of that. And so what I see when I, especially when I talk with Christians, I'm very surprised that Christians, again, don't understand who they are in Christ. They almost, without meaning to, they separate it into who I am, and I'm also going to believe and follow Christ, and not realize that you can't necessarily do that. And even when they're not intending to, I think a lot of times that's part of the problem. And so as a result, it creates that fear, and you don't want to give up where you have your identity and those worldly things. What I've also see is this, is fear ultimately becomes the lack and absence of trust. The opposite of fear isn't courage. We're taught that in movies and all different things. But reality is when you ask a Medal of Honor winner, you know, why are you know, when you did this great act of courage, they will tell you they were afraid as they did it. You know, police officers, before they go into a place, they will tell you they're afraid. So you can have them simultaneously, but fear and trust are things that you cannot have at the exact same time. So even going back to my relationship with my wife, when I was jealous and I was afraid she was cheating on me or whatever, which she wasn't, but when I was afraid of that, then it was because I didn't trust her. So when I'm afraid that something might happen, I'm afraid I might lose my business, or I'm afraid that, you know, that a sickness is gonna take over, or whatever it might be, when I'm afraid of 2020, you know, I have to realize it's because I don't trust God to take care of the circumstance. And so what I do is I write it out on a piece of paper, and I'll say, I'm afraid that this will happen. And then I scratch that out and I write above it, I don't trust God to take care of. And then I say it out loud and I say it to him, because I think if you can't be honest, you can't repent. And so I have to say it out loud. I say, you know, Lord, I don't trust you to take care of this moment. And then at the next step is I start being thankful. It's what I talked about at the beginning of the program. And I start being thankful for the different things, and God will bring a peace to you that you can't understand, you can't explain. And sometimes that peace only lasts for a short time, and that fear comes in again, and I got to start the process over again. It's not the fact of not having fear. It's the fact of what you do when you do get the fear.
We need to just pause there for a minute and think about what you just said, because when we list out what we're really afraid of, and then we go and stamp on top of that and say, well, it's because I don't trust you, God. That's like a bullet to the, almost to the heart. I mean, seriously, if we're going to take God seriously and we want to walk with him in our everyday, we have to think about that. So, Peter, for the woman or the man who's listening right now, and they say, okay, I get what you're saying. I respect where you're coming from. I want that fearless life. I want to trust more. What would you say, and what would you give them as their first step?
Again, the first step, I think, is you have to understand, again, what you think you're afraid of, and then find the ways of the way to turn it over to him. Again, and Peter tells us we need to humble ourselves. In Philippians, it tells us we need to be thankful, you know, and so when you start kind of adding those two pieces to it, even David says, when I'm afraid, I'll put my trust in you. And David, I mean, he's the one that took on Goliath. I mean, you know, he's the one David was a very emotional fellow, but David, you know, David did a tremendous amount of stuff for him to be fearful. And he says, look, here's how I resolve it. So now again, there's the practical steps. So again, step one is, like I said, write it down and be honest. That's the hardest part of every piece of it. When I advise people that, I will hear them like gasp if I say it to a group. And then I've talked to individuals about it. I've even had people cry and say, I can't do that. I'm like, well, you can, because you're doing it already. You're just not saying it out loud. And, you know, God can handle he can handle us, you know, whatever we bring forth to him, he can handle it. So again, he can handle our honesty with him because he needs it. We have to be able to do that. And then the next step is to take a piece of paper. And I say, you write on that piece of paper every single thing you're thankful for. And then get down on your knees. And I know there's not like a proper way to pray and, you know, all that stuff. I get that. But I think there, you know, to show again that humility by getting down on your knees and just thank God. And sometimes you can't come up with anything. So sometimes you have to be kind of ridiculous on your first few items. Like, you know, I thank you that I live in a community that has a grocery store on every corner. And in that community, they have, in those grocery stores, they have aisles of cookies. I mean, you know, you can literally make it as you know, just some, but sometimes once you start flowing, now I stop at a page because again, it can keep going and eventually I'm going to want to eat dinner, you know? So I have to find a place to stop. So I usually just stop at that page. And again, I get down on my knees and I just start thanking God for those things. And I thank them individually. I don't just try to, you know, God, thank you for my list. You know, God, I thank you that I have, you know, grocery stores. God, I thank you for cookies. Whatever it happens to be that's on your list. And when you do that, and it's those are the first two steps. If then you don't necessarily have it, then as Philippians 4:6 tells us, that's when you submit your request to God. That's when you say, God, I need you to take care of this. But also again, recognize, and this is something that's there, recognize that just because it's what you want is not necessarily mean that it's what he's going to give you. So I kind of look at a lot of times as we're falling to rocks, and when we have those fears, we're falling, but God has a bungee cord tied up around us. And so you won't hit those rocks. It may appear like you are, and you'll snap back up. You may not hit the exact spot where you want to be. You may snap in a completely different direction. But at the end of the day, he's not going to let you hit those rocks. He's promised us that that's not what's going to happen. And eventually, we're going to be able to get through this as long as we continue to put our trust in him and know where it's going to be. I would also encourage anybody to look at these terrible things that's happened in their lives in the past and say, okay, this is now who you are now because of those things. You know, you would be a completely different person. You would not have so much of different positive things that's happened because of that. So sometimes we think, well, if God closes my business, or God, you know, again, you know, does not heal my parent or my child, you know, then I'm going to be, this is going to be the worst thing ever. No, it just means that he has a plan for you with that, and that God has that plan and it's perfect. And so sometimes just again, trusting in his plan, even when you don't agree with it. And I have many times have gone for walks and have told God how much I disagree with him. I have told him that I thought he'd done a bad job, you know, but I'm honest with him about it. And he doesn't always answer me right away. But there have been times where he has answered me. Like one time I brought in an employee who almost destroyed our business completely. And I was very angry with God about it. And because I had done a lot of prayerful searching to find this person. And it was a few weeks after God told me, he said, I didn't bring him there for you. I brought him there for him. And it just really like kind of hit me as a gut, which is sometimes we're so egotistical that we don't realize that some of these answers that we don't like to get is not necessarily for us, but it could be for God's greater picture and greater glory. But again, it's all for his glory. And we are just merely servants of that. So that's the big piece of it. So I think it's part of it's an attitude shift. But part of it is I think we have to do that first part of being thankful and admitting to God that we don't trust him in the circumstance.
Amen. And that honesty, oh my goodness, it is so easy to speak Christianese if we have to put a term on it, but to actually act upon what we are supposed to be following, that is where the challenge is. And I do agree with you, Peter, that honesty, that does help us to humble ourselves, to put us, and I think humble is a hard word, you know, in general, because people hear about it. You hear the songs of a very famous country star that maybe you've seen a few times yourself, you know, humble and kind. He didn't write the song, somebody else did. But we sit here and look and we're like, really humble and kind, what does that mean? How do you in your everyday allow yourself to say, okay, I'm not perfect. I do have a God and I know he loves me very much. But how do you continue to show up when fear gets there? You want to control, you're afraid to trust. How do you step back so God can step in?
Well, so recognize a lot of times in these situations, particularly with control, We like to say, okay, God, here's the remote control. Now let me tell you what TV channel to turn it on. So we like to supposedly give it up, but then we try to dictate to him how to do with it. So now from there, you know, recognize again that when you're dealing with an attitude and act of humility, that to recognize the opposite of humility is pride. And so which one are you dealing with? So what does pride look like? So when you're dealing with humility, you're saying, okay, God, you know what, it's what you say. It's me being under you. It's not humility being weak and meek. It's not pride, and where pride it can be both, you know, I can be prideful and with fake humility. You know, that's not a, you know, because what I'm doing, here's a good example. And Moses writes, and I believe it's in Exodus, where he says, Moses was the most humble man, you know, and, you know, one would think, well, that's a very prideful statement that he's just stating that. In reality is, God told Moses to write that. If Moses were to say, no, I can't be, to show humility, then Moses would be showing pride by saying, I know more than you, God. You know, so when we're dealing with that and we're trying to understand that, recognize what are the things that brings pride into your life. So how do I step back? A lot of times I have to sit there and really kind of think, okay, what's creating my problems right now? You know, is it because I'm a very competitive person? So it's like, okay, is it because I'm just wanting to win? You know, is it for the right thing? Is it for the wrong thing? You know, right now and for like the last year, I've been really kind of studying, you know, what is our obligation as Christians of civil disobedience? You know, do we fight back at different things? Or do we just kind of roll over on our belly? There's a place in between, you know, that we have to respect our leaders and yet at the same time not give in to certain areas. So I've been kind of playing with that to try to figure it out, because that's the same piece that falls under with humility and pride. You know, at what point in time do I have to kind of step back and get myself out of it and then just kind of keep moving forward? The other thing too is I got to remind myself, and a close friend of mine told me this. He said, you can't thwart God's plans. So sometimes, you know, I just kind of do my job and just kind of work forward and just say, okay, God, this is yours. I'm not going to push one way or the other. And so sometimes just not pushing in a direction and just kind of letting it happen, you'll see where God's going to want you to end up. I think a lot of times we pray against God's wishes because it's our wishes. And I think sometimes we act in a way that's against God's wishes. And so, I mean, which we're not going to win. So sometimes we just have to sit back and say, okay, I'm just going to move forward. And when you're going to reveal to me what happens, if this fails, if this happens, if our relationship that doesn't work out, you know, whatever the situation is, you know, God's putting me into a much better spot. But sometimes me fighting for whatever that happens to be is what creates some of it creates a lot more stress in your life. And again, it's a sense of control that you have. So sometimes you just have to sit back and say, this isn't working. If this isn't working, how do I turn this over to him? What can I do from there? Sometimes it's a forgiveness issue too. That's another big issue that's as well.
That is a huge issue. And y'all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Afraid to Trust, One Man's Journey into the Love of God. Well, after your encounter with God, you'd already mentioned this before, but you determined that faith was going to be a part of your business. How did you begin to fuse faith in your restaurants and how you were serving your employees?
Well, we started doing multiple things pretty quickly, pretty early on. But one of the things is again, by reading God's word every day and trying to use the lessons in there to apply. So if you wanted to talk about teamwork, Nehemiah is a great place to start. Again, you want to talk about recovering from mistakes. Again, that's Moses and Abraham. You know, I mean, you know, when you want to talk about delegation, you know, I mean, you know, Moses is talk with his father or father-in-law Jethro, you know, so there's a lot of different things that you get in there, you know, and lessons. I even have the allowing the poor to glean from what's left behind. We've kind of used some of that thinking and that thought process in Leviticus as part of in our business mindset. Also know that, again, our job as Christians is to share the gospel and make disciples. And so the next thing we would do in addition to that is, you know, people who were Christians, we started having Bible studies for them. We would do, you know, we started bringing in chaplains for both those purposes. And so we would talk about it a lot. Now, then we changed our purpose statement, and that was probably the first most controversial thing we did. Our purpose before was, you know, something to the effect of, we're going to be taking care of our customers by ensuring their total dining experience is perfect, something like that. I don't remember now. And we changed it to say, our purpose is to glorify God by serving others. And we're going to serve, you know, we're going to serve and care for our customers. We're going to serve and care for our employees. And, you know, and I looked at our managers, our general managers and above, and I said, okay, you're the ones that's going to have to defend it among the staff. So have it all out. And nobody would talk. Like, they were all scared to death. Like, I felt so alone in that room at that moment, because like everybody was just looking down, you know. And eventually we kind of got through it. We've seen several people get saved and really take this on as well. And then we've even had non-believers that would be like, no, no, we can't do this anymore because we're a Christian company, you know? And so it's interesting. It's interesting seeing that. So that's kind of how we started. I started off too fast and too rough to begin with, because I was so full of fire and I just couldn't understand why nobody else could see what I could see. So I've had to kind of pull back the reins on myself a little bit. But we've done other things such as, you know, we have evaluations of our employees once a month. The restaurant business, that's unheard of. But one of the things at the bottom of the evaluation, we ask the question, is there anything that we can pray for you over? And, you know, most people don't put anything down. Some people will write something, and some people write hateful things and make fun of it. Everything gets written down and comes before my desk. And I will pray for those, and those that make fun of it, you know, then we pray, you know, we pray that God will reveal themselves to them. So, you know, those are, but that's how we handle in those different type of ways and different things that we do from there.
Wow. That's incredible, Peter. And it's just a reminder for us that we cannot compartmentalize God. He's not just to be, you know, on a shelf that we pull out Wednesday and Sunday when we go to church. God is to be in our everyday. He's supposed to show up in our career. He shows up in the bedroom. He shows up in the kitchen. He shows up at the grocery store. And I love your story, and I cannot wait for people to go more into depth when they pick up their own copy of Afraid to Trust, One Man's Journey into the Love of God. Well, I know people are going to want to connect with you, Peter. Where can they find you?
So probably the easiest way that you connect directly with me is we have a website, which is afraidtotrust.com. All comments, anything like that, comes directly straight to my email. But you can also, you know, connect through any of the restaurant websites, and that you can, but that's a nice starting point to be able to go and kind of go from there. So, you know, if you, you know, you can see some of my speaking engagements that I had on there, and other things as well. So you can kind of, that's the kind of the good grounding spot to start, I guess, for lack of a better way to say it.
That's awesome. Well, we'll be sure to have all that information in the show notes so they can be readily accessible to all the listeners. Well, before I let you go, I have one final question. The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
What has my story gifted me? You know, honestly, I guess really, and we kind of touched on this earlier, but I would just say peace. And throughout each of these stages, each of the problems, whether it was, again, fighting with my wife or fighting with a staff member or whatever the situation happens to be, going down with a failed business that we talk about in the book, having a community turn against you because of a prayer you gave. I mean, all that stuff that's in there, you realize that being a Christian doesn't eliminate conflict, but what it does is it gives you security and peace. So I would say throughout this, and as I continue to see, and as we continue, as this story plays out through 2020 and into 2021, you know, learning that and having that peace is incredible. And that's probably been the best gift of all, which is just kind of having that and recognizing, again, you know, who he is and who I am. And that's just so, so critical and so important in all of these things.
That's beautiful, Peter. Well, I know that it's going to be a gift to many when they read your book and they really begin to digest it within their own life. I pray many, many blessings on your endeavors, because I know God has got some deliciousness, not just for your tummy, but also for your heart. Thank you so much, Peter.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.